for this invitation. This is a very general and introductory topic, talk to the questions or the open questions on the origin of life. And first of all, let me introduce what our interests, David's and mine's are. So we are both microbiologists and evolutionary biologists interested in microbial diversity and evolution. So in our team in Paris, we work together and we try to explore to approach questions on the evolution of microorganisms by studying their extant diversity today, thanks to molecular and also metagenomic approaches. And we study microbial diversity, both prokaryotic and eukaryotic, in different types of environments, going from the deep ocean to some alkaline lakes and many other places. And the idea of our research is to extract evolutionary information from this extant diversity to carry out molecular phylogeny and phylogenomic analysis and be able to propose hypotheses about early evolution in general. So that's our major interest. And having introduced that a little bit, now I will speak a bit on the question of the origin of life. Of course, it will be impossible in half an hour to introduce this in great detail, so this will be a very brief introduction. Please don't hesitate to interrupt me if you have any question during the talk. I don't mind. This can be very informal. So what can we say about the question of the origin of life? The first thing that we as scientists have to say is that this is a scientific question, meaning that as naturalists, we think that life evolved from its biochemical, its chemical roots, from prebiotic chemistry to the simplest life forms, by a process that was natural, an increasing level of complexity, and at some point that we need to define, we consider life originating. So it is a scientific question, but it is also a historical question, and that is part of the problem, because this means that there is contingency and there is a chance component. And even if we can reconstruct or imagine a possible pathway to life, and even if we can make a new life or life in a test tube, we will never be sure that this historically happened like that, unless we have a time machine and we can go to the beginning, because of this historical nature of the process. So these are the important questions about life, what is life, the definition of life. We don't have an agreement on what life is, how, where, when, and elsewhere. Is life elsewhere in the universe or in other universe? So those are very open questions. And I think during this talk, I will just touch briefly upon this, many of them being, of course, interrelated. So, how to approach the origin of life? As a biologist, I will present the biological point of view, but the question of the origin of life is highly interdisciplinary in nature, and there are two major approaches that can be taken to the study of the origin of life. The first one is a bottom-up approach. This means that these studies focus on how simple molecules build up upon atoms and how they increase in complexity to set up a prebiotic chemical world from which life evolved. So this is one possible approach. And the other approach is a top-down approach, starting from biology, what we know now about different organisms, extant organisms, and how can we imagine the simplest common denominator to all extant life forms that could perhaps get us closer to this gap, the origin of life that we are trying to tackle. And this can be done through different disciplines. For the bottom-up approach, there is the contribution of astrophysics, but also chemistry and geology, when geology tries to define what are the conditions of the primitive Earth that can have favored life, the emergence of life. And to the top-down approach, geology can also contribute by studying the oldest fossils left by life, like these stromatolites, for instance. And then there is biology, of course, that can contribute to this top-down approach, essentially by in somehow distilling what are the important essential properties of contemporary organisms that should have been there since the beginning. So, before doing anything else, I would like to set up a time framework for the origin and evolution of life. This is based on some geological constraints that we have. We know that the Earth accreted by 4.6 billion years ago, so we had a planet that had just formed and started to cool down, and by 4.4 billion years ago we had already an ocean and continents. So people think that perhaps from this moment on, the conditions might have been there for life to evolve and to emerge. The problem is that at 3.9 billion years ago, there was what people call the late heavy bombardment, which for some people might have been an event that sterilized the Earth if life was already there. So there is some discussion whether life could have evolved before or after this time event, but in any case, the geological conditions were there much earlier. So we don't know exactly when time life appeared at that time, but the conditions were there about very early, between these two periods, here around here. Then geology also tells us that the most likely the oldest fossils, known traces of organisms are fossil stromatolites found in the Pilbara region about 3.5 billion years ago. There are records of some isotopic signatures, but these are highly discussed. As we go into the past, the possible biogenic traces are more and more doubtful, meaning that there are alternative explanations for instance, isotopic deviations, but these fossil stromatolites seem like a bona fide hallmark or hint for the presence of life in the planet. What we don't know, though some people claim this, is whether there are prokaryotic microfossils associated or not, but they might it might have been there. So life appears sometime around this area. And eukaryotes appeared possibly much later. The oldest not contested eukaryotic microfossils date back at 1.89 billion years ago. There are some claims before, but they are controversial. So they appear after prokaryotes, and in particular bacteria, were there on Earth. And especially we know that the rise of oxygen in atmosphere that took that occurred somehow around 2.4 billion years ago was due to the oxygenic photosynthesis that evolved in cyanobacteria. So cyanobacteria were already present about there. So we have that eukaryotes appeared later, much later than prokaryotes, and then we have that the Cambrian explosion and the diversification of animals occurred, multicellular eukaryotic lineages occur much later. So we have that for most Earth history, life was microbial. The problem is that when we look around us today, We recognize very easily macroorganisms, animals and plants. We have been able to describe them for centuries, but it is much more difficult to differentiate microorganisms. We have first to wait for microscopes to be developed to be able to recognize microbial life in the 17th and 18th century. But then we had another problem, because if some microbes, especially eukaryotic microbes, protists, were morphologically different enough to be distinguished, in the case of bacteria, there are certainly some morphological variations, but most bacterial species are indistinguishable, and that is a problem because we don't distinguish species necessarily by this approach, and then it was not possible to establish phylogenetic relationships between them and to determine the relative order of divergence of the different bacterial groups. So it was difficult to really grasp the extent of their diversity, because they look very much the same. Even if they had some biochemical differences, etc., they were not enough. And things changed a lot during the last third of the 20th century, thanks to the development of molecular phylogeny, as you possibly know very well, based on the idea proposed by Zucker, Kandel, and Pauling, that molecules accumulate evolutionary information in their sequence, so nucleic acids and proteins in their nucleotide and amino acid sequence store evolutionary information. And this, in principle, could be used to place all organisms in a single phylogenetic tree by comparing their sequence of one conserved universal molecule. And that molecule, the molecule that was chosen during the 1970s, was the ribosomal RNA of the small subunit of the ribosome, because it's universal and present in all organisms, cellular organisms. And this led to build what we know today as the universal phylogenetic tree of life, based on this kind of marker, the small subunit ribosomal RNA gene. And this led to two things. Actually, the use of this molecule led to two things. To first demonstrate that really you could place all organisms born from bacteria to animals in a single tree. And the second thing was that at the same time it served to discover the third domain of life, the archaea, that were very similar by morphology to the bacteria, but were very different, very divergent in phylogenetic trees. And actually, with time, we know now that archaea, the molecular biology of archaea, is much more similar to that of eukaryotes than to that of bacteria. So we have this tripartite division of the tree of life, with two prokaryotic domains, the bacteria and the archaea, that resemble morphologically. Where you find the most varied metabolic diversity in terms of energy and carbon metabolism, and a third domain of life, eukaryotes, that encompasses a wide diversity. All these triangles comprise hundreds or thousands of sequences, meaning organisms, a diverse group of organisms, some of which are multicellular, that's the stars, the red stars, the animals, the plant, green plants, green algae and red algae, the fungi, the phaeophytes, the brown algae. These lineages are multicellular. But the rest of the lineages are unicellular eukaryotes or protists in general. So just by looking to the presence of stars, you can already say that multicellularity arose independently several times. It's not a monophyletic phase. Animals here and plants here are very divergent, so multicellularity is something easy to invent, in nature. But most of this diversity remains unicellular. So, using this kind of molecular tools, we have been able to set up this phylogenetic tree as a backbone for microbial evolution. But also, these tools have allowed to explore microbial diversity in nature, in very different environments, going from the seas to soils. So we have now a much better picture of the extent of biological diversity, and especially microbial diversity on Earth, thanks to these molecular tools, including environments that were thought previously to be sterile. These are called extreme environments. So you find different kinds of organisms, essentially prokaryotes, sometimes eukaryotes as well, but microbial, in high salt environments. We call them halophytes, or in alkaline environments such as soda lake, or in very acidic environments such as acid mining rivers, or even salt Sahara-like settings, where you have organisms being able to grow at pH 0 and below, and organisms that can resist high levels of radiation. And perhaps the most fascinating extreme environments that people have studied and are pertained to the origin of life, and you will see that later, are hot environments such as volcanic hot sources or deep sea vents, where you find organisms that are called hypothermophytes, growing optimally at temperatures higher than 80 degrees. And the records today for hypothermophily belong to organisms that live in deep sea vents, because here you have water that can be kept at a liquid state at temperatures higher than 100 degrees. So the records of hypothermophily today are held by archaea, so this prokaryotic lineage, and belong to these two organisms, Phyllolophus fumari, growing between 90 and 130 degrees, and Lethanophilus candleri, this particular strain, growing up to 116 degrees in the lab at let's say, atmospheric pressure, and up to 122 degrees at the pressure that is typical of its natural habitat. And there are also other environments that are important in this sense, and it's the increasing discovery of life in the deep subsurface, so in aquifers and in small crevices and fractures in the rock, in the continental and oceanic crust. And this is important because all this information and this type of habitats have led to the recognition that the range of physicochemical conditions within which life can exist is much larger than those that we thought at the beginning. And this extends the range also of planets, or habitable planets, where you can try to find life. So this is important for people trying to look for life elsewhere in other places. And in the case of the solar system, there are two bodies that have attracted the attention. One is Europa, that may perhaps harbor an ocean under the ice cover, and also Mars. Not today, or at least not at the surface, it's an sterile planet, but at the beginning, because at the beginning of Mars history, the conditions were very similar to those on Earth, so why not? Life might perhaps have appeared also in Mars and left the traces there. So there are people looking for that. Okay? So that's a general question, life elsewhere. But let's stand back to this tree of life. Despite this large diversity of organisms within these three domains, there are some features that are shared by all cellular organisms, such as the biochemistry, the basics of biochemistry. We all use the same 20 amino acids, more or less, or derivatives. And we use the same DNA and RNA material and the four bases, essentially, for making our DNA and RNA. We have the same genetic code with little variations that can be shown to be later divergences. So all these features suggest that the three domains of life derive from a single common ancestor that lived there at that long ago, and that from which the three major lineages diverge. So now this ancestor was likely not the first cell. And David will tell us later more about this organism. So this organism appeared to be something already quite complex, so that most likely it was accompanied by the divergence of other lineages that finally got extinct, so that the question of the origin of life is to be placed here, much earlier. And perhaps there might have been other departures of life from a prebiotic world, and even perhaps some of them have possibly contributed somehow to this successful start of life. But these two events, the last common ancestor and the origin of life, are separated on time. So the origin of life corresponds to the first kind of cells that appear from the prebiotic world in their that were much simpler than the last common ancestor that we can deduce from comparative approaches from today's genomes. So this would be the view that we have today. There is some prebiotic chemistry, we can study some of it. There is a step of first cells, and then there's an ancestor, or the last common ancestor, which is something that appears later. The major question here is how this transition from non-life here to life here appeared. And the basic question is something like this. If you thrive, if you draw a graph showing a complexity or liveliness, if you want to compare through time, there are two possible ways to see this transition from non-life to life. On one sense, we can have a progressive increase in complexity, and at a given point that is more or less arbitrary or conventional, we decide, by convention, we put life here, we decide that this is already alive. This is one possibility. And the other possibility is that at a given point, in this increase of complexity, there is really a transition point, and something happens that makes the system have an emergent property, and this is life. So this would be a definition of life that is somehow independent of convention. There is really a transition state. When we don't know, we don't have the answer, so this is a complete open question. Now, we don't know how to define life, because in principle there are two major schools that oppose, and this results from looking at cells. You can say that cells are the minimum unit of life that you can find, and everybody would agree that a cell is alive. So cells have dual nature. On the one side, they have information, they store information that they transmit by replicating DNA, which is the storage compound information that contains information, but they can also express this information by transcription and translation to make proteins and other things that make structures and functions. And on the other hand, cells have also functional properties that are called metabolism, because they are able to transform energy and matter for their needs. So these two properties are somehow mirrored in the two major schools with regards to the definition of life. So there are many, many definitions of life. Many of them are very descriptive, but when you take them to essentials, those that are minimal definitions that would really tackle the essential properties of life, they can be divided in these two opposite schools. One school that would say, I would say it's the metabolist view, for which the keyword is synergy, and the important property of cells or of life in general is self-maintenance, the capacity to keep over time, to keep the system during time. And on the other hand, so this type of view would please physicists. So cells would be, or and life would be viewed just as a thermodynamic system that is far from equilibrium, and in a sense is something that creates order from disorder. On the other hand, we would have views that we could call geneticists, and those views would please very much biologists, especially molecular biologists and today's biologists, because the keyword here is information, like the information that you store in genomes. You can analyze by analyzing sequences. And here, for these views, the important property of life is self-replication and evolution, the capacity to evolve. Okay? And of course, these two definitions translate in two different kinds of models of how life emerged. For metabolist hypothesis, the first thing that appears is an autocatalytic network of reactions, a metabolism, if you want, and a genetic system comes only later. And for geneticist views, we have just the opposite. We have that the first thing that appears is an autoreplicative system, and much later we will find that metabolism and a full cell will come. But at the beginning, what we have is a self-replicating gene, in a sense. So these are the two opposed kind of models, but there are many models. And these models also differ in the type of environment where they propose that life emerged. And in essence, there are, again, two major kind of settings. On one hand, we have the idea, a cold heterotrophic model for the origin of life. There are various. And here, the founder could be Alexander Oparin and John Haldane, that more or less at the same time proposed that life emerged in a kind of shallow pond or shallow system where from inorganic molecules, simple organic molecules formed. And that was what Haldane called a primordial soup. And Oparin would propose that quaservates would form in this type of setting by the action of ultraviolet radiation and perhaps electric discharges from storms. And then we would have a complexification of the system. On the other, these type of models were supported in a sense by the famous experience by Stanley Miller in 1953, when he mixed a variety of reduced gases that he thought were important in the primitive atmosphere, and by applying heat and electric discharges over some time and recycling all this, he could found the spontaneous formation of organic molecules, simple organic molecules like amino acids, but many other things, organic compounds as well, in this flask. So this was like a kind of support for these initial ideas. The other kind of environments where people have proposed that life emerged are hot systems, and in particular in this case we have that only autotrophic models of the origin of life would be suitable for this kind of environment. One such example is the iron sulfur world proposed by Gunther Wachter-Poiser in the 1980s. And here for him, the first living organism would be bidimensional, would be formed just by an autocatalytic metabolic network on surface or on mineral surface happening in the deep sea floor at very high temperatures. And here you would have redox reactions with conducive to carbon fixation. So the autotrophic property, the capacity to fix inorganic carbon, CO2, into organic matter would be the first metabolic capacity of these systems that he would call alive. And only later there would be the addition of the genetic machinery. And in his view, nucleic acids appear first for their catalytic capacity to make peptide bonds. So in this sense, it is the opposite than other models. Another model that also is similar, except that it adds a third dimension, but it also proposes this kind of model in hot deep sea systems, is the proposal by Bill Martin and Mike Prasser, at the beginning of this century, that life would have formed in hydrothermal chimneys, in a sense, where alkaline fluids, very hot alkaline fluids, encounter an ocean that is much colder but also much more acidic. And in these conditions, you have the precipitation of iron monosulfide and also other minerals forming algorithms where you can accumulate different kinds of material. And these algorithms, mineral algorithms, would serve as chemical reactors where life, little by little, would progress. The problem with this model is that they propose that the last common ancestors, so something already quite complex, had only mineral membranes, and we will hear more about this. So this is another kind of model on stage. Faced to these more metabolic-based models, or metabolism-first models, we have others that were genetics first, and the first of which is the idea by Hermann Müller that the first life form was a simple gene, a gene. And then other people have proposed that before DNA polymers, there would be other kind of polymers, such as clays, for instance, where you can have some kind of copying or replicating activity by adding these leaflets one to the other. And if there is a mistake, the mistake would be like a mutation that can be copied by the next shift, etc. So these are some of the models that were there at the time. But for a long time, there was this dichotomy between metabolism first models, so between actually the idea of catalysis, function, metabolism, and genetic information. There was a fight or a dichotomy, a dialectics between proteins and DNA. And this, at a given moment, was substituted by RNA. Because, and this occurred when ribozymes were discovered. Ribozymes are RNA molecules with catalytic activity, so that the idea came that the first living organisms would have been just RNA molecules that contain at the same time information that were capable of making activities. And this idea was much more supported when we discovered that RNA in the ribosome acted actually as a catalytic center. So actually the ribosomes are ribosomes. This is at the heart of the cell. So the RNA world idea has really spread, and many people think about this as a very likely model. Except that there are several problems with this RNA world model. The first of which is that there are many RNA worlds, there are many hypotheses under that term, and we now need the details, because originally the people that proposed the RNA world model were thinking on RNA alone, but actually there are others that have included the presence of peptides, and others that include now in also membranes. So this is it's a wide set of different theories or hypotheses under the same terminology, and this is confusing, especially because an RNA-only world is highly unlikely. Why? First, because it is very difficult to synthesize RNA. RNA is highly labile, now there is John Sutherland in England has proposed a model to synthesize RNA under abiotic conditions, but these are not realistic because he needs some input formula or something, and it's likely not the case in the LDF, and also because amino acids were there. We know that amino acids are in meteorites and are everywhere, so amino acids and small peptides must have been there before RNA, happened there before the beginning. And also the other problem of the RNA world is that it does not resolve the origin of energetic metabolism, because as you know, essentially cell metabolism today, energetic metabolism is based on the chemosmotic theory, so in on the creation of a proton gradient across the membrane, and energy is gained or is stored in ATP by the passage of these protons along the gradient. So this is a general property that was shared by the first cells, and that is not explained by the RNA world. So this is an open question. And this brings us to the origin of cell compartments and membranes, because these were the last common ancestor, at least, must have had these kind of membranes. So membranes are phospholipid bilayers formed by amphiphilic molecules with hydrophilic heads and hydrophobic tails. And we know that amphiphilic molecules auto-assemble spontaneously under given conditions, so fatty acids and isoprenoids, but also the kind of molecules formed by layers that can form micelles. And much more interesting structures such as liposomes or vesicles, more or less the same, because they encapsulate a volume of hydrophilic solutions. So these could act as chemical reactors in principle, because they can accumulate material inside. And actually, if you extract organic matter from the Murchison meteorite and from other chondrite meteorites that have organic matter, and you put this organic material in solution, vesicles will form spontaneously. So these are pictures, this is the work of David Limmer in the US. So these vesicles can form spontaneously. These are very interesting reactors, and perhaps one could think about the origin of life like a combination of the three elements, where a kind of metabolic compartment, a vesicle that can encapsulate metabolism and a genetic system interacting between the three. So meaning a co-evolution of the three systems. And this is highly likely when you look at the dual nature of cells today, where the two systems, the metabolic and the replicative systems, are highly implicated. So this has been proposed theoretically by some people like Tibor Ganti in the 70s, but only from a theoretical point of view. And this is also the way that some people are taking now in practice for doing what we call synthetic biology, trying to reconstruct life in a test tube. And just as a few brief examples, I will mention the work by Jack Szostak, but also Jerry Joyce, using vesicles that can encapsulate RNA. For instance, they can grow and divide spontaneously, and they can form incipient ion gradients. And when you put two different ribosomes inside, they have managed to cross-replicate spontaneously. So these are interesting systems. Perhaps favoring this idea that these vesicles serve as initial protocells and incorporated catalysts and the first genetic molecules within. And with that, I'm going to stop here. And say just by saying one thing, and it's that even if we get this in a test tube, we will never know if life originated this way because of its historical nature. And now I'm going to stop here and thank you for your attention. Thank you. So if you have questions, don't hesitate. Yes, please.
Hello, I have a question. We know, well, according to all the knowledge we have nowadays, we know the function of life, we are trying to find the origin of life, but what is life in general? It's a series of processes, it's a reaction. How can
that could take several months of discussion between different scholars. Okay. We don't know. I said before, there are many, many different definitions. Many definitions are just descriptions, and describing is not defining, it's not abstracting properties. So what people try to abstract, or a proper definition would be something like the properties of a system. Okay? And this is what I said, is there are these two schools favoring the properties of self-maintenance or the properties of self-replication. That would be an ideal definition. But there is also a discussion of what a definition should be. And then you can meet scholars that would say, okay, a definition may be simply a list of descriptions. And there are some definitions that are a list of the components of the self. So you have 40 different features of life. Those are not useful, because at the origin of life, there were not the 40 components were not there. So there must have been one or two components. The definition that is now favored by NASA is just an autochemical a system that is a chemical system that is capable to keep over time and self-replicate. So actually, it implies the two opposed definitions, that the property of self-replication and the property of self-maintenance work together. So it is favoring this coevolution view that I presented at the end, and I think that it's very difficult to separate the two in life today.
So it's like a cycle.
I don't know. There's not. It's one of the open questions. I can give you mine, and I would favor this joint definition, the coevolution definition. The two properties need to be together, but. Some of the people could tell you a single replicative agent, a virus, is alive. So, if you are here tomorrow, I will discuss more about that point.
Thank you.
Any other questions? We can also have some questions during the break.
Okay, or along the week if you are around. Okay, thank you.